Welcome back to Guru Talk, the show where we get really in depth on all the great, subjects that everyone wants to hear about, whether they be drugs, diet, training. Today we're going to actually talk training. And who better to talk training with than the mountain dog himself, John Meadows. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on, Dave. I appreciate it.
You know, John, I did an interview with Dorian Yates in Dubai about a month and a half ago, and we talked strictly training. It was pretty much me as a fan asking him all the training questions that I always wanted to ask him back in the 90s when he never talked to anyone. And it was very popular, and I know you have a very good following in terms of your mountain dog training routine, and I think a lot of it's based on also heavy lifting. And you know, you see all these people out there nowadays that want to do this high volume training and light weights and high reps. And, you know, I just personally don't feel that really builds muscle. Give me your whole philosophy on training and like what the synthesis was where you actually found, you know, that one day where you said, you know what, I got this thing figured out.
Oh boy, well, I'd be lying to you if I said I got it all figured out. Let me give you some thoughts I have off the top of my head. I love to talk about training, so I really appreciate you having me on.
Yeah.
I think with my philosophies, there's, let me just break it down to the basics, first of all. So when I think about training, I think, first of all, at the most fundamental level, you have to feel the muscle that you're training. So if you're training your back, for example, you're doing rows, chins, whatever you're doing, and if you can't really feel your lats, I don't think you're ever going to reach your potential as far as building muscle. So number one, you have to have a good mind to muscle connection. And I really think the bodybuilders in the 80s and 90s were, Dorian, guys like Dorian, I think they were very good at that. Mm. I think it was very intuitive for them. The other thing I would say is what really creates hypertrophy? How does a muscle grow? And everybody always says overload. And I 100% agree with that. It definitely is overload. So, you know, what creates overload? You've got to activate everything that you can activate. And you know how you do that? You work it two ways. You work at 85 to 90% of your maximum, which is a pretty heavy weight. You know, right. You're thinking 5, 6, 7, 8 reps. If you're working close to failure, at least with that kind of percentage of your one rep max, there's a good chance you're going to activate everything.
Sure.
The other side of that is if you do lighter weights. Now you have to, in my opinion, now you got to go to complete failure. Mm-hmm. And I would say most people don't really go to complete failure. I think that lighter weights, you know, can kind of help save your joints and things like that. But I think it's a little misleading to tell people you're going to build a lot of muscle with lighter weights. I do think if you back off, you know, 70, 75, 65% of your one rep max and you're taking those to failure, I think that can be a good stimulus. Conversely, if you're working 85, 90% of your one rep max all the time, you're probably going to have some problems with your joints at some point, your connective tissue, your shoulders, your hips, your knees, your back. You know, for me, I got to be careful with my back.
Right.
So I think there's this combination that you have to use for longevity and building muscle. You need the heavy weights, but you can't be the guy that says, well, I'm just going to go heavy every single time I'm in the gym 365 sure. days a year. Or your career is going to be short-lived. I think you got to figure out ways with the lighter weights to continue to stimulate your muscles without always using the heavy weights. Right. Now, having said that, unless you're Vince Taylor, a guy who was able to build muscle with light weights all the time, you still need that heavy stimulus.
Right.
So I think you got two ways. You're going to use a little heavier weight, maybe not go to failure, but close to it. If you're going to use a little bit lighter weight, you better go to failure because it still boils down to muscle tension. The weight is light, but if you're going to failure, you know, the earlier muscle fibers are going to fatigue, right? So then you call in those high threshold motor units and they have to work. So you are getting to them eventually. But honestly, Dave, I think the biggest problem with people now is people are so scared of overtraining. And if you go into the gym, like how many people do you see you think are overtraining in a gym? Mm-hmm.
There's a couple like lunatics there, yeah, that are probably there for 3-4 hours, you know.
Yeah, but not many. Most people are maybe overtraining their thumbs. But in terms of actually training, I think people have this fear that they're going to overtrain. And I've always like I've always said, you never know where the line is until you cross it a little. And I think the guys in Dorian's era, I think the 80s and 90s guys, they didn't have this fear of overtraining. So they worked really, really hard. Mm-hmm. And I think that's part of the reason why their physiques had that nice, dense look to it. I know you train that way. You had that dense look as opposed to this Stay Puft marshmallow look that a lot of the guys have now. Yeah.
Well, you know, I just wanted to make a statement because it's ironic. It seems like when you first start training, that higher volume, lighter weights seem to work better because you're building kind of those like mind-muscle connections, so to speak, and really feeling the weight. And I had to be honest with you, I had to throw out a lot of exercises that other people were doing because I just never felt them. Skull crushes was, for instance, a movement for triceps I just never felt. I think I have a very long arm and it didn't work for me. And you know, so if you don't, like you said earlier, if you don't feel the muscle working, then you're not getting any benefit out of it. And then when you hit a point where you get the mind-muscle connection, you build a little muscle, now I think it's important then to move to that next stage where you're actually pushing, like you said, the 85%, you know, max weights, because now those heavyweights are going to build muscle. But then at some point, once you build the muscle you need, which usually takes about, you know, I think about 5 years is usually when you hit your maximum muscle potential, assuming that you're doing everything right, then it seems like you have to back it down a little bit because you don't really need a lot more muscle. You need more quality at that point. Plus, you want longevity. So it's almost like you go back to what you were when you first started later in your career. And I'm sure as you get into your 40s, I know you're feeling it. Obviously, I'm feeling it. I just got, you know, my second shoulder replacement on the other shoulder. I can't wait to go back to the gym. I certainly won't be trying to lift for any records, but I would love to be able to stimulate the muscle again, you know?
Yeah, and you know, when I set up my workouts, you know, the kind of the design that I have is the initial part of the workout is using an exercise that you feel really activates everything. And the second thing I do is typically a movement where we go pretty heavy, a 5, 6, 7 rep. I never really go below 5 or 6 reps. I don't really see a whole lot of benefit. Well, you look at risk versus reward. There's probably more risk than there is reward. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of how I stagger stuff, and then we do some other things. But you know, the other thing is, I was talking to my training partner about this today. The three exercises that I like the most are squats, deadlifts, and an incline barbell bench on a slight incline.
I agree.
100%. Those are the three exercises I love the most. But you know what, man, about when I hit 43, when I did a real heavy squat workout, the next day I couldn't get out of bed. My back hurt so bad. And I, you know, and then maybe a year or two later, the same thing happened with deadlifts off the floor. And then I had 3 months ago, I was doing incline barbells, which is like the only exercise left that I really, truly just love.
Right.
And I almost tore my pec. It's the first time that's happened in probably 15 years. I had 275 on there, a weight that I can typically do 8 to 12 reps with.
Sure.
And it was black and blue the next day. And I dropped those. And my partner and I were talking today, and I was like, you know what, man? If we were stubborn and we were one of these Instagram hardcore guys, we'd have just kept doing this stuff. And we probably would have torn something, you know, by now. But sometimes, man, you just got to let it go and find exercises that just feel better. Right. You know, I started doing a lot more. You know, I read many, many years ago, Dorian Yates liked to use really slight angles on incline and decline.
Yeah.
And many years ago, I started doing that. It was directly from what he said, and I loved it. And I do a lot of my dumbbell work. If you look at what I'm doing, I'm always telling people to use a slight incline decline. I got that straight from Dorian. So I've been doing a lot of this dumbbell work, almost just all dumbbells and machines, and my chest looks, it didn't lose anything.
Once you build that muscle, I don't think the muscle goes away so quickly, John. That was my, you know, experience at least. You know, once you have that mass and it's been on your body for a while, you could almost do machines and really maintain it at that point. I mean, I think look at Dexter. I mean, I don't think Dexter's getting under a squat bar and doing crazy heavy weights anymore, you know?
Yeah, 100%. There's a big difference between building muscle and maintaining it. And not only training from a dietary perspective, you know, I eat about 150 grams of protein a day now, and there's no way I could have built the muscle mass that I did.
No.
But maintaining it's a different story. Sure. I think that once you've really paid your dues, you've put in the work, I 100% agree with you. There is a big difference between maintaining and building. And I try to tell people, they're like, well, you can't grow 150 grams. I'm like, you're not listening to me. I'm just saying maintain what I've already built. Like right. if I went back to 20 and 30 years old, no, I wouldn't have built a lot of muscle in that.
No.
But now it's a different story. I've got 30 years under the bar and it's a little different.
Yeah, no, I noticed that too. Matter of fact, I had to almost starve myself to lose muscle because it just wouldn't leave my body. It was weird. And I tell people this, and I don't know if they believe me. I say if I went back to eating 6 meals a day, nothing else, didn't, you know, I'm not even on a hormone replacement. I haven't been on it for 5 years. And if I just went back to eating 6 meals a day and training, I would probably put 25, 30 pounds of muscle on if I wanted to. I know I could do it because I just know the muscle memory would come right back. It's that muscle doesn't go away. And even though it might atrophy a little bit, it will come back fast if you put that stimulus back and that food back. And it's, you know, that's not to say, like you said, you can't do that to build the muscle initially, but once you got it, it'll come back. It's amazing.
Yeah, it'll volumize and it'll fill right back out. Yeah, absolutely.
And people think, oh, I'm sure if I did that, people would think, oh, he's on a ton of stuff, you know, and it really has to do with more with just being able to activate those muscle fibers. Because I know once the shoulder heals up, if I go back to the gym and train upper body and I'm not going to be in pain, I'll be able to activate everything. And I know while it might not look as pretty as it did, you know, when I was younger, the muscle will come back and will fill out. And I definitely want to put some muscle back on. I don't need to put 30 pounds on, but I'd like to put another 15 pounds back on. And I have a feeling it'll probably take me 6 to 8 weeks to do it just by eating and training. And I think that has a testament to what you've been doing earlier in your career. Now, so the question, you know, comes back to, John, there's people out there watching this. I want to put on maximal muscle. What do we do? John, what's the advice? What, you know, a guy, he's been training, let's say 2-3 years, and he wants to take it to that next level. He wants to add some density and thickness. What do you think is the best protocol at this point?
Well, number one, I would start with effort. People are in this never-ending discussion now on volume and frequency. And before you even can entertain that idea of volume and frequency, you got to understand effort. How hard are you working? Are you really working hard? And what I mean by that is I believe that when you do an exercise, at least the last set, probably just the last set, you should take to failure and sometimes beyond.
Yeah.
Not all your sets.
What does that mean? Explain what you mean by failure to people.
When I say failure, that's a good question. When I say failure, I mean you've completed as many reps as you can do.
Well, I think we got a little hiccup here in the internet. We'll get John back. This is an interesting question because, you know, people define failure as different things. You know, when I would define failure initially when I first was training, you know, it would be like, all right, I can't do any more reps. You know, I'm on the set and I can't do any more. But really failure is you got a training partner there helping you get, you know, an extra rep or two out, really squeezing, you know, not cheating, but squeezing, because that's failure. Because that means taking you to the point where even with a spot, you can't do anymore. I remember doing a set of like hack squats to failure. And, you know, literally my training partner helped me with a couple more and he's like, come on, let's do one more. And I literally could not do one more. It didn't matter how much he helped me. It's just like my legs they were not firing the muscles anymore. So John, we got you back. I was just giving my personal experience with what failure was, but I'm waiting to hear your definition because I think it's the viewers out there would like to know.
Yeah. So two things. When I'm using like a compound movement, like a squat or say a barbell bench press, it means that I can't complete any more reps with good form. Like you take a deadlift, for example, let's say you can do 5 reps with perfect form. I wouldn't want someone to do a 6th rep with really bad form.
Sure.
And the reason is because I want you to stay healthy. And then the other side of that is now you can also go beyond failure on some of your sets. So I think you mentioned the drop set on squats. I used to do videos with Dave Tate out of the Elite FTS on Saturdays, and our last set was an insane drop set to where we would almost pass out. Dave just wrote a thing on his log about how he basically passed out, he puked in his mouth, and he woke up and he peed himself. One of those sets he did.
That's hardcore now. Yeah.
That's how we used to train, our last set, man. And that's kind of how I look at it. When you do your exercises, the last set is a real high level of effort. So when you talk about building muscle, the number one thing is people, you got to have that high effort. No, I don't think you can do that on every set. I think that's unnecessary. once you destroy the muscle fiber on that exercise, I mean, what do you want to do? Just keep beating it into the ground. And that's why kind of the volume discussion becomes, you can only do one set with that kind of intensity.
Right.
You can't do four sets like that in a row. That's just dumb. And, you know, before I move on, when you talk about volume, a lot of it's semantics. Like, for example, you'll get someone who does, like me, for example, let's say I do a couple sets of 20 to warm up, and then I do three sets of 8, and then I do my really hard set. Now, I can show that to somebody, and I can say, we're only going to count your last set because that's the hard one. So they say that's one working set. That's low volume. Now, I might say to somebody else, I want you to do three sets as you're working up to that last set,
right,
and then your last set's the failure. And they'll say, okay, that's four sets. The reality is it's the same thing. It's just semantics.
Sure.
The main thing is, and that's what Dorian did. He didn't just go right to his heaviest set.
No.
You know, he didn't walk into the gym and go, okay, put 365, I'm going to do some supinated barbell rows. He worked up to that.
Yeah.
That's the same thing I do. We're talking the same language. In that last set, Dorian would go really hard. And that is what I believe builds muscle too. You take that last set and, man, you go balls out. You go really, really hard. So that's kind of like step one. And then you kind of get into the finer details, you know, well, how often can you train the muscle? And that's dictated completely by recovery.
Sure.
You know, whether you're natural, you're not natural, that's completed. That's just dictated by recovery. If you train your legs on Monday and they're still crazy sore on Friday, don't train them on Friday. They're not recovered.
Yeah.
You know, the way that you can overtrain your muscles is you keep repeatedly training when they're not recovered.
Mm-hmm.
If you do that for a long period of time, that to me is how you overtrain your muscle. There's certain theories on doing it for a short period of time where you get this super compensation. But for a general philosophy, if you keep training a muscle before it's recovered, number one, your performance is going to suffer because if a muscle fiber is damaged, it can't produce as much force.
Sure.
So that's going to translate directly into your performance. So why would you want to do that? You know, that just doesn't make any sense. So then you get into that conversation where, okay, I've stimulated protein synthesis, I've recovered, now I can train the muscle again. And then, oh, by the way, muscles recover at different rates, right? So your legs might be sore for 5 days, whereas your chest might be sore for 2 days. You know what I mean? And
sure.
So that's when you kind of get into the not necessarily, it is a science, but it's also the art. Well, how can you build your training program now?
Plus, you know, everyone's variable. I mean, you look at Ronnie Coleman. Ronnie Coleman was able to train with that level of intensity each body part twice a week. I don't think many guys can recover from that type of training. I know I couldn't. Once a week I was having trouble doing it. He was doing each body part twice a week like that and recovering, obviously, because he was growing and getting better and better. Now, I don't know if that had any long-term repercussions on his body, but he certainly was, I would say, recovered. Would you agree?
Yeah, look at how he grew. I mean, you're totally right. The guy was growing, and I used to watch his training, and I'd just be like, I don't understand. How's this guy doing this?
He did volume too, a lot of volume.
He was volume and intensity and high frequency. He was doing it all.
Yeah, that's called genetic gifts, from God.
Yeah.
So when you set up a program, is there a time frame that you'll have someone train with this level of intensity? Because what I would do is I would pretty much train like that the whole off season, like the way you're kind of describing. And then, you know, pre-contest, obviously, I wouldn't purposely lighten the weights, but the weights just got lighter. You know, I added some more exercises just to get some, to compensate for the fact that I wasn't as strong. And then usually after the show, I would kind of like just, you know, for like 6 weeks or so, I would train, but I wouldn't really be trying to set any records. That's how I just intuitively structured my training. How do you set up your training, you know, year round in terms of people doing shows versus off season versus kind of like a rest period?
Well, when you're headed into a show, I see all these people saying, bring down your volume immediately. You know, you're in a caloric deficit. I don't necessarily believe that. Here's what I say. Bring down your volume when you notice you have problems with recovery.
Right.
You do get to a point where you're in a caloric deficit that your recovery, it's just not as good. So you either bring down your volume or you give the muscle more time to repair. Instead of maybe taking 3 days off, maybe take four, maybe take five before you train again. But don't just automatically bring down your volume. You listen to your body. Understand how it's recovering, and that is how you determine what you want to do. Now, when you talk about, let me say this too. I think a lot of people pre-contest training, they start going into the gym and they start saying, I'm going in here to burn fat.
Right.
And so they change their program. They start doing all these lightweight and high reps. I'm like, no, no. You're going into the gym to build muscle, or at the minimum when you're dieting, the minimum you at least want to maintain muscle.
Right.
So go into the gym, fed, and train hard. Like, that's the last thing you want to have happen, is to change your style to this light pumping style when you're getting, I guarantee you, it will not, you will not look your best when you get on stage.
No.
So now then you get to the post contest thing, and I do the exact same thing you do. I figure you got all these calories coming in. We'll keep training. We'll put them to use. But think about how lean you are. Your joints aren't as cushioned. You don't have as much fat in your joints. So if you're going to go balls out with heavy weight, you're asking for an injury.
Yeah. Definitely.
You're just asking for an injury. So that's when I kind of will do a little bit more volume with a little bit lighter weight. You got all those calories coming in. You'll put them to use. But to go in and start doing really, really heavy stuff with joints that are maybe not necessarily at their best is a recipe for disaster.
Mm.
And then after about 4 to 6 weeks, that's actually when I have my people take a week or two off and, you know, kind of rest, mentally recharge, and then they kind of work back into their off season, start working that intensity back up.
Yeah, because I kind of feel fresh after a show because you want to get back in the gym, but like you said, the strength is not there. And I can't tell you how many guys I've seen tear pecs right after a show. I remember Craig Titus went to Gold's Venice, and I don't even think he warmed up, and guys were benching, and he felt really strong because he was all like water retentive after the show, and he was a strong bencher. He got into like 550 or something like that and ripped his pec. I mean, he was lucky. It was an intramuscular tear, and whoever repaired it did an amazing job. You could never tell that he tore it, but things tear. You don't have that. You think you're stronger than you really are, and that's the danger of it, because you're kind of artificially strong, but you're really not,
right?
You know,
right? It's just the water rebound.
yeah, exactly.
That's right.
It's like wearing a bench shirt that just snaps. You know, you don't want that bench shirt snapping on you. You know, that's it's not really that very. It's not that reinforced, so to speak.
Yeah, absolutely.
When you are training, you know, and for maximal gains, okay. At what point is too much too much? In other words, when do you say, okay, it's time to back it down? Do you wait till that point where you feel burnt out and overtrained, or do you kind of set up a schedule where you're saying, okay, I'm going to go 8 weeks really hard, and then even though I might still feel good, I'm going to back it down, you know, just to kind of give my body a rest for a week or two?
Yeah, that's the tough one, because if you look at the strength communities, the powerlifters, the Olympic weightlifters, those guys have the science from the East, you know, from the Soviets, from the Bulgarians. They have really good ways of peaking for strength and then backing off. But bodybuilding is a little different animal. You know, what you find with people is they have varying amounts of, they can tolerate various amounts of stress. Some people can tolerate that really, really hard training for, say, 4 weeks. Some people can tolerate it for 12 weeks. That's where, this is one of the things in bodybuilding, it's always been a big challenge to me, is trying to understand how much stress somebody can tolerate.
Mm.
So what I usually do, kind of go back to what I said earlier, you never know where the line is and you cross a little. I like to see where people, what they can handle. Let's see what you can handle. And then if I see that you can't handle it, let's say all of a sudden your strength starts going down, you know, your peak force is negatively impacted. Let's say you're all of a sudden you're not recovering. Let's say you're not sleeping as well. Let's say you started seeing these symptoms. Then that's your body kind of telling you, hey, man, you might want to back off a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But if somebody is kicking butt, they're doing awesome, and they're growing, they're getting stronger, I won't tell them to pull back. I don't care if it's been 20 weeks.
Gotcha.
Man, you just keep cranking. Until we see some signs that your body's having trouble adapting, then we're going to keep pushing.
Mm.
So that's kind of the way I've approached it, is I'm just going to keep pushing and pushing and pushing until I feel like, okay, now we're kind of in that, we've crossed the line a little bit, now we need to back off.
Right. How do you like to break down your body parts for training, in terms of, like, you know, which, do you train body parts together? Do you separate them all? How do you break, what's your schedule like usually?
Well, I like to train shoulders with chest. And the reason why is because I feel like our shoulders are a joint that's real vulnerable to overuse and injury.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like when you load your chest and shoulders on the same day, then you don't have to come back and load them again. Like if you did chest Monday, then you did shoulder Wednesday, and then you did chest Friday, I think you're just loading your shoulders, I feel like, are pretty delicate.
Sure.
So I like to train chest and shoulders together. I actually, I actually like to train. If someone has a propensity for bad elbows, I like to put their biceps with back, because I know when they go into their bicep workout, their biceps are warmed up, their elbows are warmed up, right. they're a little bit fatigued. It doesn't take as much volume, so you're not as susceptible to overuse. Same thing with your elbows when it comes to triceps. If you kind of got beat up elbows, hey, let's take your triceps, let's put it with your chest. They're going to get some work when you're doing all those presses. Plus, they're going to be warmed up. Plus, we won't need as much volume. Mm-hmm. If somebody has super awesome elbows, then we'll train our bis and tris together. Mm-hmm. As far as legs, I've always liked training quads and hams together. I like all that blood at once into that kind of that whole compartment.
Yeah.
And that's actually why I like doing bis and tris together, too. I feel like when you get all that blood in that one compartment, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and insult your intelligence and tell you you're stretching out your fascia or anything like that. but I do feel like there's something there when you really load that whole compartment of blood. So mm-hmm. I like doing quads and hams together. And then sometimes I like, if somebody needs extra ham work, which you're one of the few guys in the sport, Dave, that had awesome hams. Mm-hmm. I think there's a general lack of hamstring development.
Yeah, I agree. Then
I like to have people maybe put some hams with their back workout as well. Mm-hmm. You know, if they're doing some deadlifts and things like that, there's a little bit of a synergy there.
Sure.
So they can throw in some extra hamstring work. That's kind of like, you know, that's just some thoughts off the top of my head, how I would structure a program.
Yeah. And I agree. And I switch it around too. You know, throughout my career, I did different stuff. I actually did shoulders with chest for a while and I kind of liked it. But what I would do is I would do another day where I would do like the lateral raises and stuff like that. Just the pressing overhead I did. And I felt, you're right, I felt it gave my joints a bit of rest. And then, you know, I had, like, my arms are not my strongest body part, so I like to train them alone. And yeah. I think what happens when you train the same compartment like you were mentioning is, you know, you get a lot of that local IGF-1 release, which is known as mechanogrowth factor, and yep. it's kind of released into that local circulation there. And I think that that MGF is basically looking for destroyed muscle fibers. So if you're in that same circulation right there, you can train your biceps and your triceps and they kind of get that cross contamination, dare I say. The mechanogrowth factor can kind of find that area pretty well. It's not going to go to your legs, but it's going to stay in that local blood supply there. And I agree. And of course with legs, like you mentioned, every compound leg movement you do is using hamstrings and quads and adductors, so you really can't isolate, you know, one or the other in that respect. So I guess, you know, that's why I always kept them together. But you're right, pre-contest I always throw in an extra hamstring day just to do my stiff-legged deadlifts and, you know, maybe some extra single leg curls and stuff like that. I think there's nothing wrong with that, but I agree with you. I like to train those body parts together.
You know, you just coined a new term, cross-contamination training.
There you go. Someone will probably trademark it. I better do it quickly.
I want to see an ebook in 2 weeks, all right?
Cross-contamination.
Well, but you know, the IGF-1 conversation is interesting because when you train at long muscle lengths, that's when there's a lot more damage and there's mm-hmm. a little bit of evidence to show there's a little bit more IGF-1. So
yeah.
When you're training that muscle, when you load it full of blood, then like, for example, when you do a preacher curl, when you really stretch the bicep, or like even better, like let's say you do a incline dumbbell curl where you really stretch it out,
yeah.
or if you're doing triceps and, you know, you got your humerus pointed up and you're really stretching,
yeah, like
there is some evidence that stuff is training at those long muscle lengths too, also is very effective for IGF-1. So I think that's a very interesting topic to me.
Yeah, I think it is, and I think it's something that needs to be explored more because there is that, you know, you have the systemic IGF-1 that's released from the liver that's in response to growth hormone, but then you have that direct IGF-1 locally, that mechanogrowth factor, just another name for it, that's released in response to training and to stress on the muscle and to stretch and to breaking down of muscle. So it's weird, but it's the same essential IGF-1, but it's just released locally. And that's why people think, well, if I inject MGF locally into the muscle, I'm going to get growth. Problem is, it doesn't stay there. It goes into the circulation
right.
and it's out.
This is
something that's trickled in constantly throughout the workout as damage occurs. And I think there's definitely a way you can capitalize on that if you train properly, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so, man. I think so. Then, you know, there's another interesting concept there too. When you get a muscle loaded full of blood and you really put a stretch on it, it creates, I don't want to say blood flow restriction, but you can get some vascular pressure that does kind of create a little bit of occlusion. And there's some really interesting science right now with blood flow restriction where they're showing it's increasing collagen synthesis for people's joints. They're showing high threshold motor unit activation with all these lightweights. So I don't know, man. It's just a really cool topic that maybe in 10 or 15 years we'll know more about. But I just always have liked that load your muscle full of blood. Yeah. I can't sit here and tell you I'm an expert in what it does, but it seems like you hit the heavy weights, you get to that 85, 90% of your one rep maximum, you throw in some of that stuff. It just seems like a great combination to me.
I think this occlusion training type stuff, I put that in the same category as those EMS muscle machines, you know, where you put the pads on and it stimulates it. I think the research that shows that, oh, occlusion training builds this much muscle because they just occlude the muscle and they put it under a load, or is the same as when they put those EMS machines on people and they see, oh, they build muscle. Yeah, in a very small amount. But when you're in the gym and you're bench pressing, you know, 500 pounds, supersedes those little small effects. But I think what's happening is there's like a microcosm inside of that muscle that's occurring, like you said, that you might be getting occlusion while you're training that heavy with that much blood that's going on in there. You're getting activation like you would with the EMS machine, obviously, because you're purposely activating. So all those little experiments they do on the side all come into play with what you're doing on a basis where you're actually benching. So you don't need to do all these extra things because it's already occurring while you're training with that kind of weight, you know?
I mean, at the end of the day, you're going to have to exhaust the muscle with, again, some kind of weight that's between probably 70 to 90% of your one rep max. At the end of the day, I think you've got to do that.
Yeah, there's no shortcut to that. You're not going to put a machine on yourself. You're not going to, you know, wrap a blood pressure cuff around yourself and mimic that. The only thing that's going to duplicate that is doing the weight.
You know, I used to perpetually pull my groin, my left adductor.
Right.
So I used to have all these videos where I had knee wraps wrapped around my groin because I didn't want to tear it off when I was squatting.
Right.
And all of a sudden people started saying, man, Meadows is doing occlusion training, all of his leg workouts. I was like, I'm not doing occlusion training. I'm trying to keep my adductor from blowing off my leg, man. You know, so.
It was like people used to come to my house back in the day when I was like really big. They would come over and they'd see like canisters on my like a kitchen counter, like that were not labeled. And they would be like, oh, I knew he had some secret he was holding back from us, you know? And it was just that the label fell off or something like that, you know, because it got wet or something like that. People assume there's this magic. The only magic is being consistent, going to the gym and training your ass off. That's really the only magic.
Yeah, man. I started competing, not training, competing when I was 13. Uh-huh. I actually posted in a Facebook group yesterday, I found a score sheet. Do you remember back when they used to send us score sheets after we competed?
Yeah, that's because there wasn't as many people in the show they could actually do that.
I found, there wasn't 1,000 people. Yeah. I found one of mine from 1986 or 87.
Oh, wow.
And it was 86. And I was 14 years old, and I posted it, and it had my score sheets, and there were four kids in my class, and my my score was 4-4-4-4-3. When I got that, I was so excited. I was like, one judge had me in third instead of fourth.
Who was the head judge? Probably like Gary Uter or something like that. Still around back then.
It was, you know what? The judges were all listed. It was back when, you remember when Perillo, John Perillo and Jim Van Flandern were the chairman?
Sure.
It was a Perillo and Van Flandern panel.
Oh, wow.
And I actually trained at Perillo's back in the early 90s. Was back, you know, kind of the Franco Santoriello days.
I just interviewed Franco Santoriello the other day. It's going to be up on the site. And he was talking about Perillo. He actually said Perillo was the guy who put me on the map. It was never Cybergenics. He said, I never even took the Cybergenics products. So.
Oh, that man, training down there, that is where I was always a really, really hard worker. I mean, when I was 13 years old, I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but I worked hard.
Yeah.
And when I went to Perillo's, man, those guys, my first trainer was a guy named Mike Mattson. Uh-huh. Mike is one of my best friends to this day.
Wow.
I still keep in touch with him. And Mike demanded excellence from me. And he pushed me. I mean, I didn't really understand how much you could, how much pain you could tolerate. Yeah. And the thing about Perillo's is John and Mike, when you started feeling a little bit of pain, that to them, that's when your set started.
Right.
Like they wouldn't even really, I don't even say they would even really count reps. It was just when you were in pain, it'd be like, okay, now it's time for the work to start. And Mike drilled into me, man. He drilled it into me, the fundamentals of training and nutrition.
Right.
When I went up there, I was training natural. And I had just won a show, 19 years old. And then I did my first men's open show at 20 years old. And I won the overall. And I didn't even really understand what all the drugs were and all that stuff. But I can tell you what I did know. And that was those guys beat me into oblivion, man.
It was training. Yeah, it was about the training.
I mean, we would do Smith machine squats. And I wouldn't think I would do, I could do another rep. And Mike would grab my waist and say, keep going, keep going. And it was brutal. I did a show where I started cheating on my diet. And I won the light heavies, but I lost the overall to a little middleweight dude by 2 points. And I'm in a parking lot, and I'm feeling good about myself. Yeah, I just want to light heavies. I'm a tough guy. And I'm talking to my girlfriend. She's out there, you know. My friends are out there. And Mike walks out there. Mike was my trainer, right? Mike walks out there, and he looks at me, and he said, you let yourself down. And I just was like, I just... He said, you and I both know you've been cheating on your diet. I know how you can look. And when he said that, there was nothing I could say because he was right.
Oh, he was true? Oh.
He was right because I was, you know what it was? I was actually following the if it fits your macros type diet.
Oh, my God.
And I was, what I was doing was I was replacing all my carbs with frozen yogurt.
Oh.
And I just didn't have quite the same look to my body eating all that frozen yogurt.
Yeah.
And so when he did that, I was ashamed, and I never cheated on my diet again before a show. That's like, awesome. I was so humiliated by that. I never wanted to feel that again.
Yeah.
So that was it.
That's awesome. It's always good when you have that one person in your life that really made an impact on you, and it probably changed the way you view bodybuilding for the rest of your life, too. And it probably translates into how you train other people to this day. And I have people like that in my life as well. You know, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, I was always fortunate because I surrounded myself with some, you know, like a guy like Dave Tate. Dave was, I don't know if you know him or not, but he is a straight shooter. And I knew that Dave would never tell me I was ready until I was ready.
Yeah.
So anytime I got a compliment from Dave, I knew, okay, I must be in pretty good shape. Because I knew he just wouldn't casually hand out compliments.
Yeah. Now, my friend Doug Wentz was the same way. And
I remember him. Yeah, remember I competed against him several times.
Yeah, Dougie, you probably competed with him. He was brutal. He never gave me a compliment. One day he gave me a compliment, and he's like, holy mackerel. He goes, you look fucking great. This is before I won the heavyweight class at the Junior Nationals in 95. I'm like, Doug gave me a compliment. I'm like, I must really look good.
That's funny.
That's the same way. Tough love, you know?
That is funny, man. I was talking to my training partner about you today, and about two things. I said, do you know that Dave still has that old AOL email address? He's had that for like 50
years. I do.
He's had that for like 50 years.
Yeah.
And then I said, we were talking about Junior Nationals. And I said, I remember when Dave did Junior Nationals, man, that was a sick package you had at that show.
Yeah, that was like when I was really, really influenced by Dorian. And, you know, I wanted to look like him more than anything. And I really dyed my ass off. I wanted to be like granity, grainy hard for that show. And I was, and you know, that was just like, I try to take the conditioning to the next level. And, you know, I think after that, a lot of people started, you know, trying to emulate that look. And I got a lot of business from that, you know, just from people saying, coming to me, after that, to be honest with you, that's when Kevin Lavroni contacted me. He was backstage at that Junior Nationals. He's like, what the hell did you do to look like that? And to me, he was like a hero to me. I was like, this guy's asking me what I'm doing. You know, and I actually worked with him the following year for the Arnold and helped him, you know, win Beat Flex Wheel that year. So that was like a huge turning point for me. And I think that it was, once again, it was something that no one had done on an amateur level, at least. And so it made me, you know, someone that people wanted to talk to. And people got to remember, there was no internet then. It was just whoever was at that show saw me, you know, those were the people that were influenced. But people went to shows back then, John, because you couldn't see bodybuilding otherwise, you know?
Right. Right. Now, yeah, the only thing we had was the AOL bodybuilding Facebook group, or the AOL group.
Yeah, right.
The AOL chat groups was all we had.
Yeah.
And the shows, I mean, the the contest reports didn't come out until like 3 months afterwards.
Oh yeah.
So, you know, no, you're right, man. I love thinking about the 90s, and I love thinking about all the stuff we did back then. It was just really fun. It was a great time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if I do compete next year in 2020, I would have competed in the 80s, 90s, the 2000s, 2010s, and 2020s.
That's crazy. People like you, people tell me I should make a comeback now. I'm like, all right, I'm going after Meadows. This, you know, people, if I say that now, people will be like, Meadows and Palumbo on stage again. Oh, my God. I'm not making a comeback.
You know what I always thought would be cool is if we had, like, a coaches contest where all the coaches compete against each other. We could get, like, Shelby. We could pull Shelby out of retirement.
He'd come out in 2 seconds for that, yeah. He's probably ready to compete tomorrow if he had to, you know.
That would be so much fun, man. I always thought that would be cool.
Yeah. John, thank you so much for giving us your wisdom on training. I know a lot of people have been asking me a lot of training questions. I think the show was very helpful, useful, a lot of great insights. And once again, thanks for taking some time. How do people get in touch with you if they want to sign up with your Mountain Dog training and all that great stuff?
Yeah, well, my website is mountaindogdiet.com. And I've also been working really hard on my YouTube. I would appreciate a subscriber there. And then my Instagram is also MountainDog1, so but my website, but if you want to contact me directly,
sure.
MountainDog1 on YouTube and on Instagram.
All right, guys, go subscribe to his channel. Make sure you turn on your notifications so you get all the latest Mountain Dog updates and videos. And that's going to take us to the end of another episode of Guru Talk. I'm Dave Palumbo for John Meadows. We'll see you next time.